Canton Metal Decorating Company, founded in 1933, styled itself a manufacturer of a complete line of metalware and commercial decorator of tin mill products. Its assets came from the old Canton Art Metal Company, which had operated successfully for 40 years, but had unfortunately needed bank loans in 1929 to complete a move to a larger plant. After October 1929's crash, there were very few bank loans anywhere. In August of 1945, Canton Metal Decorating announced it would move its operations to Massillon, and a month later broke ground on 16th Street Southeast, just south of Tiger Stadium. The firm also changed its name to Ohio Can and Crown, although the first few newspaper accounts called it Ohio Crown and Can, and declared its intention to manufacture a general line of plain and lithographed cans and do commercial decorating of tin mill products. Key figures were C.W. Lappin, president, A.P. Pal Richards, VP and treasurer, James R. McCuskey, plant manager, and John Baugh, sales manager.
I'm Dick Dietz. I worked in the tool room for 31 years. My roots go back to the beginning. My father, Ray Dietz, worked at Canton Metal Decorating, came over to Massillon with the start of Ohio Can and Crown. This photo shows me 4 years old, and my dad used to bring me up here to play ball in this Model T Ford. Ohio Can and Crown was in C building, what we call C building now. There was no A or B building. They didn't exist.
A great deal went on during these early years in Massillon. Using 83,000 square feet of manufacturing space, the company became one of America's largest producers of metal wall tile. In 1951, for example, it made 35 million pieces of wall tile, as well as 1 million lunch boxes and another 1 million waste baskets. That same year, Jim McCuskey was promoted to vice president of operations, and Roy E. Rice succeeded him as plant manager. Ohio Can and Crown became obviously active in civic affairs, as the company's employees in 1951 contributed $500 to the Red Cross drive, a 70% increase over 1950 and 67% over their quota. There was a walkout eventually involving about two-thirds of the workforce in August of 1951, and two men were charged with assault and battery for attempting to interfere with the coming and going of other employees at the plant. 1951 saw other strike threats, and 2 years later came an attempt to decertify the union, which caused the resignation of the United Steelworkers local president, all of which led to an unfair labor practice charge against the company.
Well, we had a Wildcat strike. Ohio Can and Crown, and guy was the assistant foreman on the tile line. He wanted to help dog mad the union, and he had John Dunn, the union man from outside, coming in. They investigating. Wasn't no union scout. He was trying to get one to go. And this John Dunn, he told Pal about the 6-7 trip he made that he wanted a closed shop. Pal told him, say, if they close, I close it, and I go to Florida and sit on the palm tree and say, these people got to make a living. So anyone that want to join the union, join it. They welcome to, but the one, you're not going to force nobody in it. They ain't going to have no closed shop.
In February and March of 1953, lithographers voted 2-1 against any union representation, and other employees voted 3-2 not to decertify the steelworkers. On March 26, 1954, the Ohio Can and Crown Company announced plans for a complete liquidation of its assets, and at the same time revealed plans to form an entirely new, much smaller company. 5 days later, a news release announced that Ohio Can and Crown had sold its automatic can department and litho operation to A.P. Richards, who would be sole owner of a new company to be called Central States Can. Richards announced that Jim McCuskey would become general manager of the new company. Then on December 30th, Central States Can announced it would begin production with 83 employees in the Ohio Can and Crown plant starting January 3rd, 1955, and that it had purchased 9 acres near the same site for the purpose of building a new plant. Jim McCuskey, who would operate the business from day to day, made another important announcement at a December 30th dinner meeting of all the firm's newly hired employees. He gave details of a new profit-sharing plan in which all employees would participate, and which he said should add substantially to their earnings. Thus, the new business was launched. Its only products at the beginning were round cans and metal jackets for vacuum bottles, and some commercial coating and lithography services for other companies. But it had extra land and plans for a new building, and it had dedicated, skilled, and aggressive people all through its organization.
We've only just begun to live.
Central States made plans in the summer to move all its lines to its new building, which was to be dedicated on August 9th, 1955. Then at the beginning of September, the new company and its new plant held a 3-day open house, which Jim McCuskey said was meant to show we are a part of the community and want to do our share in running a plant that Massillon will be proud of. One note of heroism from CSC's first year must be recorded. George Henning and Raymond Dietz, according to the Massillon Evening Independent, rescued a dog trapped in company piping when it chased a rabbit into the new plant. From such humble beginnings, great things sometimes grow. A banner day for the new company came on January 28, 1956, when 83 employees divided $84,300 in profit sharing at a dinner held at the Massillon Club. This represented 29.9% of straight-time earnings. Jim McCuskey remarked at the dinner that true and successful profit sharing provides extra financial rewards, but it also does much more. It shares common interests, purposes, and efforts which act as a vigorous incentive to improve, to achieve, and to be a part of the team. It is, in a sense, a very personal thing, which has intangible personal rewards, too. Throughout these first few years, Central States made metal cans for such dry products as Boil Midway's bowl cleaners and cleansers, and in early 1957 announced plans to buy equipment to make battery cans, as Ohio Can and Crown had done. The company was prosperous and well-run, but could see the time coming when the kind of growth desired would require access to larger sums of capital for buying appropriate equipment and getting access to more space. Accordingly, on Monday, October 7th, 1957, CSC employees learned that A.P. Richards had sold Central States Can to the Van Dorn Ironworks of Cleveland. The announcement was made public the next day. Van Dorn at that time made jails and steel mailboxes. Their plastic machinery company, started in 1945, made injection molding machinery. Van Dorn also owned the Colonial Plastics Manufacturing Company, bought in 1950, which made plastic pipe, and two can companies, Davies Can, 1944, and Conneaut Can Company, which became part of Davies in 1956. At that time, Al Smart was managing Conneaut Can and had an 11-year-old son named George. Above all, from 1958 on, Central States had a particular goal in mind, one that no can maker had as yet accomplished, and a great many had never even thought about. This was to make a seamless aluminum can with an easy opening lid, capable of holding processed food products. For some 2.5 years, CSC worked with E.W. Bliss Company on the equipment and Kaiser Aluminum and Chemical on the materials needed to make the new containers and closures successfully. The new can would be cost competitive with steel cans, Jim McCuskey said in a news release of October 1960. But would have several outright advantages over steel and glass containers. A full-fledged publicity campaign got underway, with major articles appearing in newspapers and trade journals, sporting such headlines as "Can Opener Doomed by New Self-Opening Type of Container," "Tear Top Aluminum Can Unveiled," and "Aluminum Has New Entry in Can Race." Jim McCuskey even predicted that by the end of 1961, most tuna fish packed by West Coast plants would be in aluminum cans. The future was to be very good indeed, but not quite that good. Within a few months, however, Kraft Foods had announced the introduction of 5 cheese products in the new single-drawn cans in both 8-ounce and 4-ounce sizes. Then Campbell's Soup announced a new line of dry soup mixes under the brand name of Red Kettle to appear in CSC's new double-drawn package. Seeing a need for product diversification and looking for future additional uses for easy-opening lids, Central States in 1963 made 2 important moves. First, it purchased the Ohio Paper Products Company to get a foothold with composite cans. Then, in the last week of the year, it announced plans to build a new plant of about 24,000 square feet to make blow-molded containers for household products. The site would be on 5 acres just south of the Whitmer Jackson Company plant, which is now C Building. Ground for what would be B Building was broken on April 1st, 1964. At about the same time, big things were happening in Central State's easy opening aluminum can business. Armor Grocery Products Company of Chicago announced in March 1964 that they would pack Vienna sausage in the first easy open can in which food would be processed in the container itself. Since 1960, the Alcoa-designed easy-opening closure had only been used for such products as orange juice with a composite body, and then beer, never for food processed in its container. The new zip-top can replaced old-fashioned key-opening models, much to the relief of consumers.
And it's ready to serve for breakfast, for lunch, for all your favorite sausage dishes. So look for Armour's Vienna sausage with its gleaming foil label and new all-aluminum zip-top can from Reynolds, where new ideas bring you better packaging. Reynolds Aluminum Packaging.
Central States throughout the remainder of the 1960s extended its aluminum container to several new products, from chilies, stews, and pasta dishes, margarine and cream cheese, to dog food.
Dips like this now come in easy-to-open zip-top cans of Reynolds Aluminum, made by the Central States Can Corporation, and so do these other fine food products.
The cans, too, were developed and modified to include an 8-ounce line, especially made for vending machines, and a further refined opening feature. Reflecting in March of 1968 on what had been accomplished, Jim McCuskey said, "We found nobody knew anything about making aluminum cans, and we decided to try it. We chose manufacture of drawn cans as our goal and committed the whole net worth of our company to the experiment. I sometimes wonder why we did it. As it turned out, it was a success. But if it hadn't been, we'd all be looking for or working at other jobs now." A further important milestone was passed about this time. On Saturday, February 10th, 1968, Clara Murray celebrated her 90th birthday, calling Central States the best place in the world to work, and went back to her job in QA as always the following Monday.
Massillon, Ohio Evening Independent salutes Clara Murray, employee in quality control at Central States Can. Though she could have retired on Social Security 25 years ago. That's right, the wonderfully cheerful, everyday, regular employee, Clara Murray, is 90. You know, when she's not working, the widow Murray takes care of her own house out on Gibbs Avenue.
Continuing its interest in plastic containers, CSC moved into a new building in the spring of 1968 in order to manufacture a cube-shaped, stackable polyethylene bleach bottle for the Climalin Company of Canton, Ohio. The new plant itself was located in Itasca, Illinois, near the filling site and main marketing region around Chicago. The new package was to win a special award from Food and Drug Packaging magazine.
Landed.
1969 was, of course, the year U.S. astronauts landed on the moon, and Central States Can, already honored splendidly when its filled products made the trip too, got a spectacular windfall of publicity when on July 21st, Buzz Aldrin used a CSC can of tuna salad sandwich spread to demonstrate the principle of the gyroscope to tens of millions of TV viewers.
I applied the torque this way, it's rotated this way.
You may still see that can at the Smithsonian National Air and Space Museum in Washington, D.C. The advertising coup of the moon landing came at an auspicious time, since later that same year, Central States began producing 5-ounce aluminum cans with a new full-panel pull-out lid for Hunt Wesson, aseptically filled snack packs of puddings and fruits. And a short time afterward, Castleberry Foods ordered CSC cans and lids for a line of hot entree foods for vending machines. And as if to prove how hot the new EZO aluminum cans were, Frito-Lay introduced a jalapeno bean dip in both 10-ounce and 3.25-ounce cans from CSC. George M. Smart, who had begun his career with the organization by working summers during college at the Conneaut Can Company, then part of Davies Can, went to Van Dorn Corporate in 1969 and to CSC a year later, was appointed director of marketing.
How can I be sure?
In a January 1972 interview in Industry Week, Jim McCuskey touched the heart of the matter in commenting on the company's quarterly profit-sharing meetings. "We don't think there's any show of paternalism in this at all," he said. "We simply think there are brains all over the place, and we want all the active intelligence we can get to work from the bottom up." Central States would soon make important use of its active intelligence as a firestorm of complaints about the sharpness of the panel removed from the new snack pack can hit the news. A group of George Washington University law students formed a committee using the acronym SLICE, Students Litigating Against Injurious Cutting Edges. They contacted Congressman Paul G. Rogers of Florida, who chaired the House Public Health and Environment Subcommittee, and called a news conference on January 25th, 1972. The congressman horrified mothers everywhere with reports of children cutting their lips, tongues, and fingers on pudding can panels, and even demonstrating the cutting of a thick beefsteak with the panel's sharp edge. To this semi-panic, Central States very quickly offered the triple-fold lid. Articles explaining the new safety feature and showing illustrative drawings appeared in such leading trade journals as Packaging Digest and Modern Packaging by May and June, respectively. Complementing the triple-fold lid was a deepened neck bead in the can body itself. The bead put a rounded metal surface just below the exposed edge and projecting toward the can's center, well beyond the sharp edge on the open can rim, thus acting as a shield for the fingers. The combination of can and lid became the Super Safe can, a very attractive product indeed, and one quite qualified now for such things as massive school lunch programs. Representative Rogers, who had done much to touch off the negative publicity about sharp edges, became a new cheerleader for Central States. If more American industries followed the example set by this company, there would be less legislation to contend with, and certainly less intervention of government into private business. "It's an example of the free enterprise system at its best," he said. In fact, by 1973, the Super Safe can earned the Putnam Food Award for packaging for the best food package improvement in 2 years. Two sad pieces of news came within weeks of one another in the first half of 1972. Pal Richards died at age 80 in April, and Roy Rice collapsed and died at 60 in June. He had been ill for about 2 months, but had been Central States Vice President of Manufacturing since 1958, and is still remembered fondly today by those who worked for him. In August 1974, Central States' interest in world markets, an interest that would continue to grow, reveals itself in the announcement of an agreement that a Japanese firm would receive CSC know-how for making drawn aluminum cans, the rights to manufacture the cans, and certain equipment and tools used to make these products. The company was Sumitomo Light Metal Industries Limited, one of the oldest and most distinguished manufacturing companies in the world. Central States' incentive to branch out from Massillon became even clearer in December 1974, when Jim McCuskey announced plans to build a 60,000 square foot plant to supply as many as 100 million units annually to the Armor Dial Company. The new can plant would be built in Fort Madison, Iowa, where Armor filled its cans. Ground would be broken on June 26, 1975, and Dick Griffith was appointed executive vice president and assumed responsibility for all manufacturing, engineering, employee relations, research and development, and purchasing. In the fall of 1976, CSC opened a new 32,000 square foot plant in North York, Ontario, with Al Houghton as plant manager. At the beginning of 1977, Food and Drug Packaging magazine selected Central States its Best Food Package of the Year award for the new rectangular 12-ounce treat can made for Armor Dial. In the same spirit, CSC in 1977 began production of the 105-ounce steam table tray, designed primarily to replace the much taller 7-inch number 10 can, which required substantially longer processing time for food products than did the new 2-inch high tray. On October 13, 1978, Lawrence C. Jones, chairman and CEO of Van Dorn Company, announced that James R. McCuskey would retire in early December and that George M. Smart would succeed him as president and CEO of Central States Can. The very small company Jim McCuskey had helped to found in 1955 had grown to $50 million in sales, 500 productive employees, and a leadership position in making two-piece aluminum cans and easy-opening lids, with a special talent for innovation in products and processes. In appreciation of all he had done for Central States, its employees, and the community, each of the three shifts at CSC sponsored a tribute on November 27, 1978, and called it Jim McCuskey Day. John Koenig was MC for the first shift festivities and called the special day a spontaneous outpouring that just grew and grew. It was a great tribute for a man who had accomplished great things.
You probably don't know me. My name's Fred Alexander, but I met you people and probably Jim McCluskey and a lot of others on Jim McCluskey Day in 1978. It was November, and Massillon had just beat McKinley 13-10. I was the guy in the Obie suit, and I presented Jim the game football. Gene Dominguez, who worked in your cafeteria, was one of our band parents, and she asked me if I could show up and celebrate Jim's retirement because he was a big Bulldogs fan, and they just felt that it was appropriate to have a Tiger present him the game ball.
The challenges George Smart and Central States faced going into 1979 were stern. When he assumed the presidency, 90% of CSC sales were in aluminum cans and lids. This was a terribly vulnerable position. There were, for example, very few aluminum can stock suppliers, and any sudden major price increase from them would put CSC out of business. Various important promotions took place early in 1979. In January, Bernie J. McKernan was named Vice President of Research and Development. Restructuring and staffing of the company's management team continued in August when Patrick L. Farron was named Director of Materials and Art Bosky promoted to Director of Manufacturing. In October, Gerald L. Bowman was named Director of Employee Relations and Administration. As if to underscore the many changes at Central States during this period, the news came to Massillon that John C. Baugh, former executive vice president and one of the founders, had died October 2, 1979, at age 71. He had retired in March of 1974. A former colleague paid this moving tribute to his old friend. John Baugh was a kind of legend in the can industry, regarded as one of the old-time can makers who wanted to adjust with changing times as circumstances changed in the can industry. He commanded the greatest respect from his fellow workers and from people in the industry. He was a remarkable, hard-working individual. He had an intuitive sense of what would go and what would not go, what was practical and what was not in can making. And that, perhaps, was his greatest asset. He was a good and loyal friend, and he believed in people and in their ability to do a job. He helped Central develop from a very small company into one that commands worldwide respect, especially in easy-opening aluminum cans. At its profit-sharing dinner on February 29, 1980, CSC celebrated its 25th or silver anniversary. The theme was Reflections of Time, and several employees brought in old cans, lids, and other artifacts recalling the company's history.
And clouds of white bright, blessed day. The dogs say goodnight. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
On November 21st, 1980, Central States sponsored an open house reception at its new plant in San Diego. George Smart paid special thanks to civic and government leaders, contractors, suppliers, customers, and CSC employees for their teamwork in bringing the new plant into operation. In May 1981, Castle & Cook began using CSC-made half-pound cans for tuna and pet food at its Mayagüez, Puerto Rico plant, 8 months after a similar startup in their San Diego operation. The new cans for Mayagüez were produced on Central States lines operating in the Bumblebee facility. Plant manager for CSC's new operation was Senor Francisco Frank Galindo, who could hardly have expected then that he would remain at this post until 1992. Moves to help manage the rapidly diversifying Central States products and plants were announced in early August. David Blizzard was appointed Vice President of Engineering and R&D, and Gerald Bowman of Administration. Porter Welch, universally known to fellow employees, customers, and suppliers as Pete, was promoted to Director of R&D. Diversification received renewed emphasis again when, in December 1981, Van Dorn announced the merger of its Ohio Paper Products Division into Central States Can. As a part of CSC, the business would be called the Composite Can Operation of Central States Can. At this time, Jack T. Whalen announced his retirement after having served Ohio Paper, which he owned before its first combination with CSC, since 1949. Daniel M. Belden was named general manager of the new CSC unit. Sales were between $4 million and $5 million annually, and Central States saw opportunities for important growth in composite cans using CSC easy opening lids. The success of the Super Safe can continued in 1982 when Castle & Cook introduced a quarter pound size tuna serving in CSC's new aluminum package to be produced in the San Diego plant. Citing the multiple advantages of the container, and particularly its safe edges for both the lid and can rim, and the absence of an internal ridge to restrict the product's easy removal, Castle & Cook lauded the CSC trademark can. They also would use the new package for cat food as well as tuna. But disturbing news was not long in coming. On April 14, 1982, Castle & Cook announced it would close its San Diego Bumblebee cannery in late May, idling about 900 Bumblebee employees, only 2.5 years after bringing the plant to San Diego. The cause was mainly an enormous oversupply of tuna on the world market, and particularly in Southern California, which had plants owned by Bumblebee, Heinz's Starkist, and Van Camp's Chicken of the Sea, as well as smaller packers. As a result, CSC moved its San Diego can line to Puerto Rico, signed a long-term supply agreement with Neptune, and thereby doubled the size of this operation. In September 1983, Van Dorn announced its board of directors had named George Smart a corporate vice president, and that he would be recommended as one of the directors of the company to be named at the May 1984 annual meeting, and he was indeed duly elected at that meeting. In April of that year, Paul H. Weston was promoted to vice president of marketing and sales. Back in late summer of 1975, a very young-looking Harry Knotts had driven south to Columbus to visit Ross Laboratories, a division of Giant Abbott Laboratories of Chicago, to talk to a fatherly gentleman named Charlie Hoover, then a major figure in Ross's R&D department.
I stopped in Columbus and visited a company by the name of Ross Laboratories and met with a couple people in the purchasing group. And I basically told them that we were a quality producer of easy opening lids and draw-redraw cans, and that very quickly got their attention. Because as it turns out, and I didn't know this at the time, but as it did turn out, they were having a lot of problems from a quality standpoint with American Can Company, who was providing them an easy opening pour opening lid for a liquid product that they were supplying. So very quickly they called over R&D technician that was their expert on cans and lids and introduced this man to me. And as it turns out, this man that they introduced to me was the real key player at Ross Labs in Central States, eventually gathering all their business. The fellow's name is Charlie Huber. And Charlie was a real interesting fellow. He was very quiet. You didn't have to spend much time with him to know that he was extremely knowledgeable about rigid packaging. And one of the first questions any salesperson asks is, what type of an annual volume do you have with this product? And the salespeople, or excuse me, the purchasing people and Charlie indicated that the volume was about 40 million units on an annualized basis, which at the time was big business. So I agreed that we would go ahead and at Central and start to develop a lid that would satisfy Ross's needs. Every time I visited Ross Labs, I would come back with a new annualized volume. And it was really staggering to me that the volume was growing from 40 million to 50 million to 70 million to 100 million. I think when I eventually ended up moving out of sales for another venture here at Central States in the QA department, I think the volume was somewhere in the neighborhood of 160 or 180 million units. And as we all know, the business now has grown to where it's approaching 500 million lids on an annualized basis, and there certainly appears that there's probably no end to the top end of that market. But Ross Labs is quite an interesting experience to all of us that have been involved with it. They're our number one customer. They're great people to work with, and it's certainly a memory that, as a salesperson, I'm never going to forget.
Right now, you're just 90 seconds away from Chef Boyardee Beef Ravioli, or 90 seconds away from Chef Boyardee Beefaroni. Introducing new microwave meals, only from Chef Boyardee. Just pull open, put the plastic top back on, and pop in your microwave. 90 seconds later, Chef Boyardee Pasta.
Always eager to explore new possibilities for food containers, Central States launched a relatively small R&D effort to make a plastic bowl. By April of 1984, Plastics Technology announced CSC's production of some prototype five-layer containers made from polypropylene and EVO, an oxygen barrier material. By 1985, things had begun to show some promise at the company's composite operations. A major opportunity had developed in February 1983 when Milton Can Company, then a Van Dorn division, decided to close down a composite can plant in Atlanta, Georgia, and CCO obtained a well-running 401 oil can line at no more expense than moving and assembling costs. For the first time, CCO could bid on jobs that would require such a line. As it turned out, CSC would never have captured the 80 million can General Foods Kool-Aid order a few years later had this line not been seized from Milton's closing plant and brought to Massillon. In April of 1986, several important appointments were announced, including two new vice presidents. Art Bosky was named Vice President of Manufacturing and Patrick Farron Vice President of Materials. In June, Central States was honored when Mark Chesterfield, the company's cost manager, was named General Chairman of the coming year's United Way of Western Stark County campaign. During the latter 1980s, CSC, continuing its pattern of geographical and product diversification, entered into a joint venture in Thailand with Unicord Limited, Thai Union, and SCT Company. The resulting effort was known as the Asian Pacific Can Company Limited.
Here's a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry.
At the end of 1987, despite the immense investment of time and money in CSC's new ventures, sales were only 1% less than in 1986's record year, but profits were almost 27% more. When 1988 was over, CSC had achieved record sales and profits and handed out more than $2.4 million at its February 25th, 1989 profit-sharing dinner. In July 1990, Central States announced with disappointment but determination its intention to end the manufacture of the plastic bowl. The bowl market, growing faster than could be controlled only a year or so before, was now leveled off and even declining, yet more and more producers had entered the field with capacity in the USA more than twice as large as demand, a condition which negatively affected selling prices. Significant changes were also occurring at the composite operations during this time period. Dan Belden was promoted to Director of Marketing and Composite Can Sales. Starting with a splendid order back in February 1988 for 10 million units of a composite version of the Calumet baking powder can, changing the self-manufactured metal can to a CSC-made composite with a new easy opening lid, CCO was able to prove its competence, reliability, and creativity to General Foods, and the giant Kool-Aid order wasn't far behind. Cans were first shipped in 1990. The same sort of pattern would be followed with Johnson's Wax and Ross Labs, CCO's first-rate performance with a small job, proving the company's worth, then major orders following after. Kurt Walderhouse became CCO plant manager in 1991, continued this formula for growth, and led these revolutionary changeovers in composite manufacturing that made the prosperity of the 1990s possible. By the end of 1992, CCO sales had increased sixfold, with composite contributing $24 million in sales and over $2 million in profits. CCO became a model for the rest of the company for employee involvement, SPC, and a teamwork approach to problem solving and continuous improvement. Persian Gulf War of January 1991 certainly gave an enormous boost to what had perhaps been Central State's most sleepy product, the steel rectangular tray.
You want to do that. But if we were to get into a ground war over in Saudi, for an example, these are the kinds of rations that you would see our soldiers eat. The MRE for the individual soldier that's forward, and at other times we'll try to get at least one of these to the soldier, a meal that's prepared by one cook, limited food equipment, and it's an excellent meal, and it's a good change from the
sales MRE boomed as Allied soldiers, including CSC's own Ben McNutt, nourished themselves with good food from these containers. And the trays led the way to a 61% increase in profits over an admittedly anemic 1990. In April of 1991, George Smart was honored by being named chairman of the Can Manufacturers Institute, and on July 25th, Walter R. Heckathorn, a Central States institution, retired after 45 years of service. Central States went into 1992 at full speed, with several important new projects either underway or already in commercial production. Recalling CSC's long history of battery sleeve production, Rayovac honored the company by making it one of its few preferred suppliers, then asked it to be the sole supplier of battery cans for a new zero-mercury product that Rayovac was literally betting its company on. A similar thing happened with the rectangular-shaped lid, something CSC had done a couple of decades before with Armour's 12-ounce treat can. Now the South American Meat Packing Company, or SAMPCO, wanted CSC to make a new steel Easy-O for its corned beef can, which had hitherto employed the awkward and not very reliable key opening feature. New things were planned for Ross Labs as well. Early 1993 promised the arrival of a new high-speed integrated lid conversion line made by the Stolle Company. It would be further integrated by connecting it to a blanking line using a new, more environmentally friendly water-based compound, and thus substantially increasing production speeds and capacities for Ross's lids. By this time, the diversification so steadily pursued since 1979 had been largely accomplished, with aluminum products at 40% of CSC's sales, steel at 40%, and composite at 20%. Any temporary difficulties in one area would allow aggressive pursuit of business in the other two. In the last part of 1991, Central States made an important commitment to world-class manufacturing standards by formalizing a company-wide dedication to continuous improvement as a principle of all company work. A core group of CSC leaders was chosen to direct this effort and to select a limited, focused number of special tasks to get it underway. Honored as core group leader was Doug Heinlein, Director of Materials. Not long after the core group began to meet, Van Dorn announced to all employees that on December 20th, 1991, Crown Cork and Seal Company of Philadelphia had made a bid to purchase Van Dorn for $16 per share. About a year later, the board announced that they had agreed to sell the company to Crown for $21 a share.
Central States has truly been a unique and extremely successful company. We have never had a losing month in 38 years, and we had a record profit in 1992 and an excellent return on assets. This is really a fine accomplishment given all the distractions that occurred in 1992 at our corporate office. Very candidly, we carried the Van Dorn Company in 1992, and for that matter, for the last 3 years. The performance at the other two Van Dorn divisions in recent years were huge disappointments and finally forced the sale of the company. Central States is a wonderful company, not just because of its incentive management philosophy and financial results, but more importantly, because of our outstanding employees and company spirit. We care about each other, and this is evident throughout the entire company in our daily actions. We may not always agree with each other, but we treat each other with respect and are a people-oriented company. There's much teamwork and a strong sense of cooperation and a very strong spirit that is very evident at CSC. There are not many companies our size where the employees take a personal interest in each other, and for this, every employee, past and present, should be complimented. I am very disappointed that this fine company of ours will no longer exist at Central States. However, it is important to realize that it will survive as part of a much bigger company. There is always change that takes place when a new owner takes over, and our situation will be no different. Crown is a good company, has been financially successful over the years, and wants to grow our business. Remember that they bought Van Dorn to get the crown jewel, so they certainly want our operations to grow and prosper. What has made Central States so special and successful over the years are our outstanding employees, our incentive management philosophy, our teamwork, and our spirit of cooperation. I want to challenge each of you to make sure that these qualities that have made Central States so successful in the past will continue to survive and thrive in the years ahead.
This is a storied history for sure, but the real story of our history belongs to the continued dedicated efforts of our number one resources, a world-class workforce. From our design technology to the production of our skilled personnel, we've always been able to give our customers the highest quality products when they wanted them, while always ensuring our profitability and never incurring a losing month.
Thanks for the memory of sentimental verse. Nothing in my purse, and chuckles when the preacher said, for better or for worse,
how lovely it was. Thanks for the memory of Schubert's serenade, little things of jade, and traffic jams, and anagrams, and bills we never paid.
How lovely it was. We who could laugh over big things were parted by only a slight thing.
I wonder if we did the right thing. Oh, well, that's life, I guess.
I love your dress.
Do you?
It's pretty.
Thanks for the memory of faults that you forgave, rainbows on a wave,
and stockings in the basin when a fellow needs a shave.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for the memory of tinkling temple bells, alma mater yells,
and Cuban rum and towels from the very best hotels.
Oh, how lovely it was. Memory of cushions on the floor, hashed with Dinty Moore, that pair of gay pajamas that you bought and never wore.
Say, by the way, whatever became of those pajamas?
Huh?
We who could laugh over big things were parted by only a slight thing.
I wonder if we did the right thing. Oh, well, that's life, I guess.
I love your dress.
Do you?
It's pretty.
Thanks for the memory of faults that you forgave, rainbows on a wave,
and stockings in the basin when a fellow needs a shave. Thank you so much.
Thanks for the memory of tinkling temple bells, alma mater yells,
and Cuban rum and towels from the very best hotels.
It was. Thanks for the memory of cushions on the floor, hashed with Dinty Moore, that pair of gay pajamas that you bought and never wore.
Say, by the way, whatever became of those pajamas?
Huh? We said goodbye with a highball.
Then I got as high as a steeple.
Did you?
But we were intelligent people.
No tears, no fuss. Hooray!